Coming on, he's from Bad Lines Back Wall. I just think it's fantastic. So many citizens have appeared to get off the ground, get out of the house, and come on with sort of thoughts and thought-provoking ideas. I think it's terrific, so thank you. I too would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the land we're landing tonight, the Gadigal land, the Eora Nation, always was and always will be Aboriginal land. Chris Masters, we know, is a legend. He's a legend.
Thank you. friends and colleagues wondered if you'd be captured by the SAS in the sense of a hero myth. You admired these soldiers, and now here you are reporting on the worst that could happen when soldiers go bad. Bullying, collusion, murder. That's a big turnaround.
And that was not, again, not getting into truth. I think one of the great ironies that I'm trying to story was the fact that I wasn't actually looking for it. I mean, I think the journalists that thought the only story worth doing in Afghanistan was the one that exposed war crimes. I'm never going to find anything because the shutters would go up, you know. Because I was there and I was trusted, inside a tent, if you like. As you say, there's a lot of criticism. If you are in bed, it's kind of a majority. You know, there is a presumption that you're all around by your nose.
Yes, like an authorised biography or
something. It always is a warning, because I don't think journalism is good judgment, and of course you're required to judgment. And the proposition coming along from people who have prepared everything they do, you know, like 90% of the media. I just thought I could do a good job, and I wouldn't go around like this. more so in special forces where their health culture takes over and their ultimate ability. Anyway, a couple of years later, I had to give a talk to the Royal Military Corps, I'm sure, and I was sitting down there, you know, with all these just splendid cadets in their perfect whites, and sitting next to a guy, and he was the other soldier who was up on the hill. So there was a battle in 2006, two Australian soldiers, Rod Smith and another guy, both awarded medals to gallantry from that battle. There were only four other soldiers with them. These two guys, they became known as person one and person two in the defamation action, and two other soldiers, one was American and one was British. So all of a sudden, there's always luck in journalism, you know, and I didn't mean to.
By the guys in the ministry for dinner.
By the guys in the ministry for dinner. And what was the best thing about that was that I knew I had to then put those questions to the guys.
Before we get to that, when you're at the dinner, sitting next to the what is it, did he tell you? You already heard that one soldier had been mad at the war by the guys, and that was the allegation from his dad. So did you just sort of then go, hey, I've heard this? What can you tell me? Or was he key to or follow? So, you know, I wasn't the only one thinking, let's get to the wild horse.
Are you getting confused?
Couldn't live with what he'd seen, that the other things that had happened up to that time.
Sure is.
Here is how I work at that. And so I got him on the phone and I told him all about it. And he was energized and so he began to do his own research. We kind of knew that nobody in the SAS in my life, there were only three SAS soldiers there. They were on Smith, first of all, and first of four. So we knew that we were probably going to get nothing out of there. I went to first of four and asked him if he talked to me. And he thanked me for my consideration. That's what he said, that he would talk.
And he did. Well, let's go to the court case now, because the civil service tribunal this week have this week lodged an appeal against Justice and the Executive findings of the defamation trial. Was that a blow for you? You've already been part of a 110-day legal trial, incredibly good. How do you feel about setting up there?
Well, they weren't directly involving all the witnesses. This will be a lawyer's lawyer thing.
Were you expecting this?
Yes, I was, yeah. Yeah, I mean, they've spent millions and millions on this so far, so it doesn't surprise me that they would take this extra step. It is disappointing, and you keep hearing this narrative about how nothing can improve yet, that the defamation action was only adjudicated to a civil level. But I think that really understates the gravity of 110-day court case where we had 20 witnesses, 3 eyewitnesses, a range of other witnesses who were believed by the judge. He had a bunch of witnesses too who weren't believed. The judge spends 10 months writing his report and 700-page judgment.
And that judgment found it was substantially true that anyone was in the case of the investigation. What we understand, the lawyers of the typical argue, is that the judge did not, quote, adequately deal with the improbability of widespread conspiracy amongst SA soldiers and Whiskey 108, the third incident, to conceal the executions that he alleged in the newspaper, and that their failure to explain why so many did not report them or do anything about them. Now, we've already talked about the fact that it's 10 years since the 2006 incident.
Further Well, look, I mean, it is getting hotter now, but the...
You still this?
The judge takes witnesses in indemnities and their rights really seriously. And so there was a situation that commonly occurred in the courtroom where a person was asked whether he was prepared to answer a question and would he seek an indemnity. If he told the truth, he received an indemnity that the information wouldn't be held against him in further prosecutions. So there were three witnesses of the court assembled. There were three witnesses who we believe were involved in blood. So they had pulled the trigger themselves. They didn't like what happened. They weren't on Robert Smith's side, but obviously they didn't want to protect themselves as well. And the same
just need to talk about it.
stuff is pretty much enough. If you've got 5,000 you say that this kind of pissing on the way, this one is certainly so big. And in a way, it's almost exactly what happened. One of the patrols that was sitting on the way, this is operating in small six-person patrols, you know, five, six-person patrols. One of the patrols, three of them had evidence for us, and three of them had evidence for us too. The whole box is evidence too. The three, the fact that Rod Smith's crew all denied that anything came out of that tunnel was a big step for him to take in a very, very dangerous time, as it turned out, because you had witnesses who had no loyalty to us or, you know, anything to Rod Smith, and they all clearly saw the air come out of the tunnel.
And that was clear in the court case that they weren't in your hand.
That's right. And I think in the beginning he thought that he was going to knock us over because he would argue that we formed this sort of improper relationship, the jealous soldiers and the scandal under the journalists.
There were rumours that were talked about,
reaching way back. Then there were your stories, McKenzie's stories, Willis's stories, the Afghan files from the NBC. Finally, the Brennan inquiry was ordered. But Brigadier Paul Brennan found in his report, quote, no evidence of knowledge or reckless indifference to the commission of war crimes on the part of the commanders or officers higher up the chain of command. I know this question's been asked before, but Chris, how could this be? And I'm generally thinking here about it. Were the officers willingly lied to them? What was going on?
No, when Brennan reported it, Lieutenant General Andy's account, read out his report. And I was there, and my question again was, these things went on between 2009 and 2013. How could it be that no one between the Lieutenant and the Lieutenant General knew anything? Now, we still really haven't answered that question. I mean, I have an answer, and I'm sure there's more points. And I think that some of the officers at court who were in the field just knew where not to look because they didn't want to.
Did they not look behind the door and see the killers?
Well, I mean, one of the funny things about the SAS was that they actually literally kept the officers out of the way.
Right.
So they had a rule that when you went into compounds, it was better to keep the officers as they could have attacked and bound the way so that they could provide oversight and command. But this is, of course, a grand convenience for them. I mean, I'm sure officers knew what was going on. Not everyone, but I think that there was an informal rule that was allowed to perpetuate, which was that if a fighting engine mine is sound in a combat zone, they're there for no purpose.
So, but what about coming back to the point of moral courage?
What does this failure of moral courage say about quality of
limited in, I'm not sure today. What more would our federal government do to improve the culture of our forces?
Just going back to that last subject, I think there's something there. I think that we still have a template for soldiering that's worn over the experience of the Great War, and the Second World War, the Korean War, the Vietnam War. I think the wars we're fighting now are not anything like that. You know, they're peacekeeping operations. So I love that idea of courageous restraint. You know, that what we need to inculcate in our people is the need to keep the finger on the trigger. And I'm not really sure that deploying soldiers to a peacekeeping environment always works, certainly in the first place.
Who would you have to do what they said?
A perfect person is someone like somebody who's backpacked, who knows geography, who might know health science, who go to villages, take a risk, it's going to be a risk, and I think they're trying to tell them to do that, you know. They actually have a way of,
what would you rate on your highly decorated hero becoming a guest at the
Richard's?
still costs $25 million. 5 years of hard work, and the media really normally acquire that endorse the storytelling.
Listen.
Absolutely. But I mean, the good thing about it is that we presume there'll be fewer than a lot of Smiths who will be thinking that, you know, they'll get a holiday or something.
Yeah, or that they'll get away with it in the first place.
It's time for us to wrap up. I started asking you about truth, which is where we started before. The book is called Flawed Hero, Truth, Lies, and More Crimes. Just on this topic of truth, in the defamation trial, that was your defense, the truth, you won, though it's now appealed. The judge concluded that you and the other journalists hold substantial truth regardless of all your own experience, all the legal assault, break moral and legal rules of the engagement. In these times we find ourselves in today, where post-truth seems to be the dominant paradigm sometimes, how important do you think was this finding for the judge, this finding of truth, right now, in the times we're in?
One of the encouraging best thing about it is that it tells the Australian public that journalism matters. I think that.
Do you think you needed that right now?
I absolutely didn't do it. And I actually was also surprised at the investment the public seemed to have in this matter. Because when I started it, it was really hard to get people interested in Afghanistan. I remember going along to a Broadway exhibition and seeing tons and tons of people turning up, paying to see, Afghanistan, and I wondered, well, you know, why that war through art is so much more interesting. I think that over time there's been an improvement of education, there's been a lot of reporting, people have paid more attention. But I actually think that the reason that a lot of people turn up tonight, us, tell me if I'm wrong, is more about truth than more crimes. I mean, we have an appetite for truth at the moment, more so than ever, because we know we're being bullshit.
Thank you so much.